Thank you, Douglas. He said he was going to say something sarcastic, but he knew better because I was speaking next. It's nice to be here. Can we have the lights down a little bit, please? Somebody running. Right, I'm going to go quite quickly because I've got quite a lot of stuff to show you and Doug will start throwing things at me. For those of you who don't know about Scotland, we are a very small country with very big ideas. Population of 5 million. Somebody described us, well, the British Isles once, as an aircraft carrier adrift in the North Atlantic. Our climate is somewhat variable. It's a geologically diverse country which reflects in the architecture, 790 islands as we've got here, and over 600,000 identified heritage assets to date. I just want to put this out there to keep you hanging. In terms of challenges for us going forward, we have all the same challenges as everybody else. We don't have enough money. We have problems getting skilled, all that kind of thing. But climate change is a real and tangible issue for us in Scotland. Precipitation has increased in the past 25 years by 25%, and is projected to do the same again around the west coast of Scotland. And those of you who have been to Scotland might imagine it can't possibly get any wetter in the west coast of Scotland, but my climate change team assure me that it is. Most of the monuments that we look after are roofless ruins. Buildings don't like not having their hats on, so it is particularly challenging for us from a conservation perspective. Very wide variety of sites, buried archaeology, Neolithic through to industrial sites, some of which are in very remote locations. As Doug mentioned, we've got about 450 staff right across the country, which sounds a lot. I could have double that. But we still have a very strong operational works department, around 300 staff, stonemasons, joiners, carpenters, that kind of thing. And we have always invested very heavily in the perpetuation of traditional skills. In some respects, the traditional skills and materials are almost as important to me as the monuments themselves, because they perpetuate a different type of cultural heritage. So, what does digital mean for us? Traditional is a word I use a lot. It's absolutely core to what we do. But over the past 10 to 15 years, digital has become increasingly important. Ingvall, who's here today, was my predecessor, and he bought a laser scanner after meeting the guys at Glasgow School of Art. And I think he wouldn't mind me saying he wasn't entirely sure what he was going to do with it, but he thought it was a good idea. We've really taken digital documentation to heart, but it's only been in the past 2 years, I would say, that the software has caught up and the technology such is really starting to integrate. Past 18 months even, it's really starting to bite for us. So it's an operational management tool, but it's also a tool that we use quite extensively for training and education, and we see it as critical for us going forward. We have quite a good pedigree. I could show you lots and lots of stuff, but I've just thrown a jumble of things up here on the surface. All the photorealistic modelling you see here is done by our friends at Glasgow School of Art, who are quite superbly talented at it. And how it tends to work is our team in-house will do the survey work and digitisation, and our colleagues at the art school do modelling work. But everything you see here is underpinned by a survey underneath. So a huge variety of projects. The one where the train has just gone through, we're working on just now, which is the fourth bridge, which has just been inscribed as our sixth World Heritage Site, largest documentation project that we've undertaken. It's taking us months, but it's really quite exciting. So in terms of documentation, we've built up a fairly extensive archive. Lots of these projects projects are within the SIARC archive, and we've had a very strong relationship with SIARC over the past years. So, this is Ben's model. It's a shame he's not here because he would have enjoyed me giving him some kind of credit for something. And this is Ben's digital process model that he came up with. I don't think it's entirely right, but him and I enjoy arguing a great deal. So this is my version. It is, of course, a circular process, and Ben is absolutely right on that. But I think what I wanted to do today was talk to you around some of these elements, probably not archive because we don't have time, but certainly DigiDoc, which we use as a shorthand for digital documentation, conservation management, and then finally public engagement. Scottish Government have been really supportive in digital work. The benefit of a small country is that you get access to politicians at a very senior level. We also happen to look after our First Minister's house, which is quite handy, and politicians in Scotland have been very supportive, funded the Scottish 10 project, and also announced 3 years ago that Scotland would be the first country in the world to digitally document all the public assets in care, its historic assets. So I can't put a time frame on it, but I think we're about 20% of the way through scanning all of the sites that we look after. So that's fine. Lots of day-to-day use on laser scanning for survey in particular, but about 18 months ago we started to seriously think about integrating digital at the core of what our organisation is about. So we'll talk about conservation management, and I'm trying to give you some very quick practical examples. We have just moved out of government to become a charity, which is interesting. And it means that we have to be much more transparent in reporting to the politicians about the condition of the assets, of their assets, and how we look after them. So that has meant a whole pile of work on technical standards, etc. But as we were developing a condition monitoring system, we had a look at the proprietary systems that were out in the market, the normal facilities management systems, and they were no use to us because they're predicated on obsolescence. They assume that a building at some point will be recycled or knocked down. That's not our business. So we decided that we would take the best of what we could see and create our own system. We're very conscious, we've been very alive to BIM, all sorts of other things that are in development, and we decided that we would build our asset management system on a modular basis, so it allowed us to replace components as technology moved forward. I have been a complete pain in the ass with my team because I want us to be heading towards directly using the point cloud down the line as an XYZ in space. It's just a coordinate, and I see that as the key route to managing digital assets. So, this is the schematic that gives our IT department nightmares. The Sigma element you see up in the side there, I'll show you this in a sec, but this is basically our means of capturing data out in the field. And I don't mean digital data. We do all the stuff that everybody else here does. We use a broad variety from airborne LiDAR down to sub-millimeter scanning and everything in between. Lots of different modes of capturing data. So the Sigma system is basically a survey tool. I'll show you in a sec. The other stuff we've got lots of really rich data assets in our organisation, but any big organisation has data assets that have developed analogously, often in different parts of the organisation. So we have things like stone databases. We have a fantastic digital archive, very much like the one our first speaker this morning showed us. And then we've got all our normal stuff, which is down here in the bottom right, specifications, very exciting things like tree audits and factoring information and all that kind of stuff. The big challenge for me is that some of my team still like working with pencils and bits of paper. And trying to sell them the notion of moving away from that and having a dynamic system has been quite a challenge. One of the ways that I think we are going to achieve that, the PIC asset management, the what do you call that thing? What's it called? Magnifying glass. Is basically the portal that our staff will go in. The film you see running in the background there is it's actually a 3D model of Stirling Castle, which is one of our properties. And we see the portal for the asset management system is being based ideally on a point cloud because it's simpler, but potentially on something that's visually very natural for our staff to go into. So the sell is that the staff can open up the asset management system, go into a site, go to a specific window within the model and then access the conservation information. When was the last time the window was maintained, painted, all that kind of stuff. So, we've just completed the development phase of the Sigma element. We work very closely with British Geological Survey in Scotland, and they had a great field survey system they'd developed over about 10 years that's a two-dimensional GIS-based system that was for geological observation. So we basically took it apart and put it back together again for buildings, because buildings, of course, are just geology reassembled. And it was actually fairly straightforward. The thinking was fairly similar. Behind all that, there's been a lot of development on a system for assessing condition survey. We're very interested in perpetuating cultural significance, risk, cost, all that kind of stuff. So the system has been designed in a way that it generates all that information for us. It generates how many roofs are needing replaced over the country in the next decade, that kind of thing. Because it's a tablet, we can do things that might not be very exciting for you, but for our architects and surveyors, engineers, things like being able to take a picture of a wall and scribble on it are pretty cool and revolutionary for these guys. They're quite excited about this kind of thing. So we have just completed a national initial survey. We've developed this thing called a monument condition indicator, and this is basically a little algorithm that basically quantifies condition versus risk, and it gives us a representation. So the stuff at the top with a high MCI number, a high monument condition indicator number, is the stuff that we need to be worried about. And quite fortunately, when the data came out, we were able to look at the sites and it all made complete sense to us. The one that's at the very top there, I'll show you a picture of just shortly. So most of our sites are in a reasonable standard. The stuff down below, the stuff we call lumps and bumps monuments, very disrespectfully, but these are largely archaeological sites that are buried. Won't surprise you, the big lumpy castles with no roofs are usually the ones that are perched on the edge of cliffs are the ones that tend to be most at risk. So, some examples. This is Scarabray, a Neolithic site in Orkney. It was actually exposed by a winter storm, built before the pyramids at Giza, just in case you're interested. This site is at considerable risk. You can see the beach in the bottom right-hand corner. All the climate change predictions for Scotland show that Orkney is not the place to be over the next 100 years. Very low-lying. Lots of submerged archaeology, actually, and really Orkney's just astounding, the archaeology that keeps coming out of the ground. Coastal erosion's a significant problem there. New sites keep on being exposed at such a rate that we can't keep up, and we're losing stuff on a fairly regular basis. Scarabray is critical to the island economy. Cruise ships come into Orkney, and we're at the stage we're going to have a serious conversation with Orkney Council about Scarabray and its long-term future. But as part of the Scottish 10 project, the site has been extensively scanned, and we are proactively using scanning and modelling. I don't have time to show you all this stuff. We're we're now scanning on a two-year cycle at Scarabray and measuring the rate of erosion loss, and it's frankly it's quite terrifying. I was there last month, having been there last year, and we're losing hundreds of tons of material, and the level of infrastructure investment required is probably beyond us, to be honest. We're now starting to look at geomorphology and modelling the hydrodynamics of the bay of Scale, where Scarabray sits, to try and give ourselves a bit of a handle on timescales and rate of attrition. But if any of you who are involved in this stuff know, it's quite a tricky task. This is Lynx of Notland. This is a site where I think we've described it as a planned retreat, but it's abandonment. Basically, we've decided that we will give this site up to the sea. It's being fully excavated and recorded, but you can see the rate of erosive loss here is fairly considerable, and this is going to be increasingly common around the coastline of Scotland and other countries, of course, in the future. Doug asked me to stick this one in, and I thought, why? But actually, this is an example of what happens when you do lose something and what can be done to recreate. In the 14th century, there was just after William Wallace, for those of you who have watched your Mel Gibson films, Robert the Bruce was a fairly, probably one of the most important kings that Scotland has had. It's the 700th anniversary of the only battle that we actually beat the English was last year, so he was celebrated fairly extensively. He was buried in Dunfermline Abbey, you see at the top left here, and during the Reformation, all the tombs of royalty were destroyed in Scotland, the tombs in Dunfermline Abbey in particular. But around 1802, our predecessor organisation discovered what appeared to be a lead casket under the floor in the abbey. You'll see the picture here on the right hand side, and it was identified as being Bruce. And the reason we know that is when Bruce died, he instructed that his heart be removed and taken on crusade. It actually ended up coming back and is buried on a different site that we own, which is quite interesting, but the poor guy ended up in lots of different places. So when that happened, elements of what was thought to be possibly the tomb were discovered. Frankly, there was quite a lot of pillaging went on, and these components ended up in different museums all over Scotland and with antiquarians such as Walter Scott. So just over a year ago, my colleague Chris and I were looking over the shoulder of an academic who sat with some tracing paper trying to reconstruct the tomb with bits of cardboard, and I'll show you a picture in a minute. And it was fascinating to us, and we both looked at each other and said, scan the bits, virtual reconstruction. So with a lot of persuasion, we managed to get all the museums in Scotland to give up all the components. Various conditions, some had been scrubbed clean in buckets of bleach, which is a good conservation tactic. And we went through a fairly extensive process, and what I think was absolutely interesting about this, and maybe a bit of a portent for the future where we might be with some of the sites that we've seen over the past 2 days, this wasn't just about digital. We had people involved. We had real expertise involved, academic expertise. We had a big dose of conservation science. We've got fabulous building stone scientists within our team who argued endlessly about the material, where it came from. There was archival research. There was research in Paris where the tomb had come to. And we ended up with a lovely little cardboard box version of the tomb chest you see here. The other thing that was very useful, when the academics were handling, obviously these things are very precious and we don't want them handled too much, so we scanned and 3D printed all the elements of the tomb chest, so it meant that the academics could sit around a table and talk and touch and feel and throw them at each other, frankly, if they want to. And it's something that we've started to do quite a lot, and it's great to be able to have kids particularly handling these type of objects. The next stage was then for the academics to work with the modellers, and this is where these guys come into their own. We start to get very excited about the reflective surfaces and how marble reflects light as opposed to alabaster and granite and all these kind of things. And I'm just going to show you a short film now. This was the result of about 18 months work, and I think is the most accurate reconstruction that we've ever done. You'll see the scanned components, so we're very upfront about telling the story about where the components went in, and this of course took months and months of debate about where all these components were. This project has been touring around Scotland for the past year. Our former First Minister was a medieval historian who was extremely interested in Bruce, and I was always nervous that he would see this and make us rebuild the tomb chest. The gilding that you can see on the stonework here was identified. We managed to find, and actually to the naked eye, you could still see elements of gilding and bowl on the marble. Interested in seeing more of that, I can show them later. The final example that I wanted to show you was a very a fairly traumatic experience for all of us that were involved. The Glasgow School of Art by Charles Rennie Mackintosh is one of Scotland's most loved buildings. And as some of you, or many of you, will be aware, there was a fairly serious fire in last May. Fortunately, nobody was killed. It was very, very close, but there was extensive fire done to the structure. This happened on a Friday afternoon, 12:30. I was about to go on holiday, and I got a phone call. My holiday got cancelled, and we were in 7:30 the next morning with the fire brigade assessing the damage. The fire service managed to do a remarkable job and contained the fire to one end of the building. Unfortunately, the fire absolutely burnt out the library, which is one of the most iconic rooms that Macintosh designed. Just a stunning space. So that's how it was prior to the fire. And unfortunately, this is how it looked on the Saturday morning when we got into the building. I'll show you shortly, but basically the fire started from a data projector, ignited, went into the wall, straight up the cavity, into the roof space, and then down into the library. What happened then, let me see, so this is the... This is the library end. The fire went up through the cavity, burned down, and what happened? The windows blew out of the library, and then of course it started sucking air in, and it just became a furnace. It got to 800 degrees in about 7 minutes, the fire crews reckoned. So it was pretty much annihilation. So the art school asked if we would take control of the building, conduct salvage operation, and very early on, there were some significant concerns about the stability of the end elevation of the building. The local council engineers were on site and frankly were terrifying me. They were saying things like, we need to get a wrecking ball in and demolish the end gable of the building. We had no information. All the drawings were inside the building. And in terms of salvage, this was our starting point. The staff were completely traumatised. And they had a young intern with them who was fabulous, and this girl sat down and sketched us out where things had been within the library and the furniture store up above. I mobilised our team very quickly. We had about 60 people on site within a day, certainly. And our digital survey team and our science team just came with equipment. It turns out we had better thermal imaging equipment than the fire service, so they were fairly enthusiastic. And this is something we do quite a lot, wrapping thermographic imagery on point clouds. You can see the hot spots in the wall here, which subsequently was really useful for monitoring the decay of the sandstone. As the building cooled down, when the sandstone started to pop all over the place, and of course huge amounts of water going on. But you'll see in the picture on the left here, we still had fires burning in places within the building. So it was a very dynamic situation. It wasn't at all safe. So the first thing the second thing we did was have our guys start to scan. The fire brigade were really worried about the load on the floor, and we're talking about pulling everything down because that's what they do. They were fabulous, and they stopped, and we had a discussion about the significance of the objects. We could see remnants of paintings and Macintosh chairs hanging half burnt from the rafters above our heads, and when we started to talk about the value, the fire brigade were really good. Able to scan that library space really quickly meant we could do some calculations and work out what the loadings on the floor were just by doing volumetric analysis. Really simple but extremely helpful. You can see the library space here, and you can see the debris on the floor here. They were really worried about collapse and allowed us to get structural support in to support that floor very quickly. We had the guys just keep scanning while they were there. We thought we might get about 8 hours at most within the building before they shut the building down. That turned out it didn't happen, but we were keen to document as quickly as we could. The building was exposed to the elements, it lost its roof, and these objects and contents of the library were getting wet, basically. The first thing we did when Chris, where is he? Over here, Chris arrived on site. I don't think I've ever experienced anything so dynamic, traumatic, people shouting, upset. There was a lot of confusion, and these building control guys wanted to take the elevation of the building down to there. Now, I'm standing looking at it thinking, that looks fine to me. And when Chris arrived on site, he said, what do you want me to do? I said, go and get those guys and don't let them knock the end of the building down. And then I didn't see Chris for about 3 hours after that. But what he did, because he's a clever chap, we actually had scan data that that elevation of the building had been scanned some years before. So we were able to rescan very quickly that elevation of the building. And then you see Chris here sat with the engineers from the local authority and convinced them that the building wasn't about to fall down. There was some deflection at the very top. You can physically see it here. It's lost its roof, so that top end. But we got them to agree that we only needed to dismantle the top 10 feet here. So within 6 hours from scan data, we've created a working drawing, and our stonemasons are in on site doing very normal stuff for us, marking up stones, dismantling it, storing it off site for proper reconstruction. And I love this example because it actually just demonstrates the power of the technology to move very, very quickly. The team then spent 2 weeks, the fire brigade, we for reasons I won't go into, we managed to keep the building open, the access open to conduct the salvage operation, and the team just kept going and just kept scanning. So we now have a fantastic model of the art school, which is absolutely being used in the reconstruction of the building and informing a fairly significant conservation debate about, do you recreate Macintosh Library, do you put a glass box in, do you do something different? And all that stuff's very live at the moment. Just finally, engagement. Doug mentioned briefly this project, which has been some years in the making. It opens next summer. It's a £9 million project for us, and it's about creating a conservation facility in Scotland that's very focused on technical aspects of building conservation. Our conservation science team, our digital survey team, our education team will all be based here. There'll be a postgrad course and a host of other things done within this building, and it's really about traditional materials, traditional skills, but also digital features extremely prominently. We have the original building here. It's an old railway engine shed, labs and all sorts of stuff here. The main space within it has an auditorium where the wall moves out. We start to do quite a lot of stuff with immersive stuff with kids. I love it. And we've got obviously huge amounts of data, and particularly through SIARC, huge amounts of data available to us. So we had this notion that it would be fantastic to be able to take something, the example I always use is the Easter Island heads, and bring them to kids in Scotland, because many of these kids, of course, will never get the opportunity. The other aspect where we are featuring digitally very strongly is we have a fantastically detailed image of Scotland from the European Space Agency, and we're using augmented reality, as you'll have seen here over the past couple of days, to layer data sets. So we kind of describe this map as our projection system. So our climate change team are developing models that show climate change projections across the surface. We can map anything that we've got in GIS, so all our sites, and then we've picked 40 sites that represent an architectural evolution in Scotland and tell a story, and allows us to drop all sorts of information into sites which otherwise could not be accessed. It's a space. This notion about being able to bring digital in and use it as a lever is incredibly important for two reasons. The politicians, when we started to engage with them, understood the importance of heritage for tourism. They got that, and it's a big deal in Scotland. What they didn't get, however, was that we were doing something that was quite cutting edge, fairly high tech, and they struggle to equate the two. They get it now. So when I go in and push for resources for heritage, I'm not talking about cultural assets for their own sake, which of course is important and is in my heart, but I'm actually talking about creating jobs, driving economy, evolution, innovation, all that kind of stuff. Digital's incredibly powerful for us for that kind of thing. This is actually my son, the first time he's ever been impressed by his father at work, and we stuck this, it's a Samsung headset on his head, and it was a wet day in Stirling, and this is what he's seeing, but there's an animation running here, but he's obviously able to move around. This is Raniki Vav Stepwell in Gujarat in India, which is the most incredible sight. It's fabulous if you ever get the chance to look. And we're now at a stage where it's reasonably straightforward to put these models into that kind of system. 300, 400 quid, very cheap to do, throw up immersive environments that we can take into schools. And it's a level of engagement. These kids are digital natives. They understand. My son, if he's like your son, sits in front of his Xbox for hours if you would let him. It's very easy and intuitive for them. They can navigate around this stuff in a way that we sometimes struggle to. Thank you very much.